Everybody,
good morning.
How is everyone this morning? You know, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we're going to do what? We're going to rejoice and be glad in it. Now, I'm telling you, the Word, and I'm not just saying this in particular about me, but with Michelle and the teaching and everything is going on, something in the atmosphere is shifting, y'all. I'm telling you the truth. And something greater is on the horizon. And let me just clue you to this. Now, I was watching television the other day, and y'all know we've been talking about the Great Awakening, and we've been talking about revival, and we've been talking about God doing the supernatural on this earth. And I was listening to one of the most prominent prophets in our nation, one of the most prominent prophets, and she said that the tipping point has begun, that the Great Awakening has begun, and the fire is getting ready to fall. It's already falling in certain places, but it is going to spread like a massive wildfire. And see, that's why I've been telling y'all, we better be ready so when it comes, we are prepared and we're ready to do. It's just like what we were seeing with this Samaritan purse. Thank you, Lord. Just like we were seeing when the emergency was happening, people mobilized together and something took place. They were ready to help. They were ready to go. They were ready to do. And I pray in Jesus' name that the shield of faith, when the glory comes, when the power comes, and as it's happening among us, that we can mobilize and we can get ready, folks, to be a lighthouse. We already are, but a greater witness for the kingdom of God. A greater, thank you, Lord. God wants this house to be like his hand to the community. Yes. Reaching, yes. Touching, yes. Constantly moving forward in Jesus' name, amen. Yes. Now, normally I don't dress like this. But the way the Lord has instructed me, you guys will kind of see where we're going with this. Let me just open up with a quick prayer, and then we're going to jump into it, all right? Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, thank you, Lord, that your word says that where two or more are gathered, you are in the midst. So, Holy Spirit, do what you planned on doing this morning, Holy Ghost. Have your way in our hearts. Have your way in our minds. Let the word go forth as you have ordained it. Let it come straight from the throne through this puppet. And that's what I am, Lord, just a puppet. And Lord, let it reach all of our hearts and minds, Father God, that we would be changed and transformed by the truth of God. And I want everybody just to say with me the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Everybody, let thy kingdom come and let will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Please forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. All right, Miss Rachel, you don't mind being my little pastor, would you mind? Oh, does she have the microphone? Now, what we've been talking about, folks, for those that haven't been here, we've been talking about the parable of the sower and the seeds, and we've been talking about the different types of soils that the seed would fall upon. First of all, we were talking about the seeds being sown by the wayside, and then we've been talking so eloquently, thank you, Holy Ghost, about seeds being planted, but there's no real depth as far as root system. But now we're going to take it down to the next two types of soil. And one is right here where you see growth, but actually there's a whole bunch of thorns and thistles that's actually surrounding the growth that's going on. We talked about that's the thorny ground. And then we're going to talk about the good ground where you see all my little beautiful plastic flowers, but they still look beautiful. Y'all get the gist, right? Now, I know I'm going to be running around, so I got to get out of this. Y'all please excuse me. Let me take this off. Okay, now, how the Lord instructed me is I have some helpers that's going to help kind of accentuate the word or the points that we're trying to get across. So we're going to have Mr. Floyd, and Mr. Floyd's going to be playing Mr. Deceiver. Oh, boy. Boo, Mr. Deceiver. And then we have Brother Charles Ferguson, who's going to play the referee, better known as the Holy Spirit. Okay. So what we're going to do is, again, we're talking about the parable of the four soils. We're talking about the thorny ground, and we're going to talk about the good ground. But let's start off with the scripture. And if you don't mind, Wanye, turning it to Mark chapter 4. And if you have your Bibles, your iPhone, iPads, whatever else you got, Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4. Okay. And where we're going to start is, let's start with verse 4. And we'll read through verse 8. Go ahead, Miss Rachel.
And as he was sowing, mm-hmm. some seed fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Mm-hmm. Other seed of the same kind fell on ground full of rocks, where it had not much soil, and at once it sprang up because it had no depth of soil. And when the sun came up, it was scorched, and because it had not taken root, it withered away. Mm-hmm. Other seed of the same kind fell among thorn plants, and the thistles grew and pressed together and utterly choked and suffocated it, and it yielded no grain. Mm-hmm. And other seed of the same kind fell into good, well-adapted soil and brought forth grain, growing up and increasing, and yielded up to 30 times as much and 60 times as much and even 100 times as much as had been sown.
Okay, and then turn to verse 14, and we're going to start reading there, and we're going to go through verse 20.
The sower sows the word. Mm-hmm. The ones along the path are those who have the word sown in their hearts, but when they hear, Satan comes at once and by force takes away the message which is sown in them.
Pause. For those that kind of missed the first two lessons, I would just encourage you, just like what Michelle said, please get the CDs or the DVDs so you can check this out. But I mean, you can hear it when she reads the scripture, what's going on. And of course, thank God he did a wonderful job explaining what these things mean. But we really want you to grab this word. We want you to get this word and be blessed by this word. Keep on, Miss Rachel. Thank you.
And in the same way, the ones sown upon stony ground are those who, when they hear the word, at once receive and accept and welcome it with joy. Mm-hmm. And they have no real root in themselves, and so they endure for a little while. Then, when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, Yes. They immediately are offended, become displeased, indignant, resentful, and they stumble and fall away. Mm.
Keep on. Verse 18.
And the ones sown among the thorns are others who hear the word. Mm-hmm.
19.
Then the cares and anxieties of the world and distractions of the age and the pleasure and delight and false glamour and deceitfulness of riches and the craving and passionate desire for other things creep in and choke and suffocate the word, and it becomes fruitless.
Okay, we'll pause right there. So we're talking about the thorny ground. Now, what I've been doing is I've been taking some excerpts from Matthew Henry's commentary, and I tell you, this thing has just blown my mind, and I just love Matthew Henry's insight. But first of all, he says about the thorny grounds. He said, number one, when the seeds were sown, that the seeds for the thorns were also sown in the mix of the good seed. So therefore, you really probably couldn't distinguish between the two, unless you're like a super expert on what seed looks like, which I have no idea. But, you know, I would probably say it all looks the same to me, and maybe it did at that particular time. But then what happened was everything began to grow. Everything began to come up. So it's not like this is not like this, because the seed was sown and nothing happened. It just fell upon the wayside. And then right here we have where the seed was sown and it sprang up, but it had no depth of root. So therefore, it looked like it was producing. It looked like it was growing. It looked like something was happening. But when you look underneath, you find that there's nothing there. And that's because the root of the word, the roots weren't planted in the depths of the word. But here, what we have is we actually have growth. We actually, you see the greenery right here. You see things are starting to bloom. It's starting to grow. And it has a good root system. It's planted in good soil. It's beginning to produce, but something is coming along to choke the growth, to choke the word, to choke up the fruit. Somebody say, choke the fruit.
Choke the fruit.
Come on, choke the fruit.
Choke the fruit.
Don't be choking my fruit. That's what the Lord is trying to say right here. Now watch this. See, the thorns sprung up, and again, it did not appear that because of the mix, because they all looked alike, yet the plant did not benefit from the soil that it was sown into, because once the thorns began to spring up, it began to start crowding. Everybody said crowding. It begins to start crowding. And sometimes, doesn't that happen to us folks? When it comes to the word, let's just be real about this thing. We get sown. We got the word. We said, okay, Lord, I'm believing. Like Brother Spence was talking, I'm believing for my healing. I'm believing, God, that you're going to do something. But then in the midst of believing for what you're believing for, anxiety, fear, worry, doubt, these things begin to spring out and start to crowd, begin to start to choke, begin to start taking over instead of the root and the word beginning to take over. Amen? Come on now, is this real talk now? Okay, now watch this. We're going somewhere with this. Just let me kind of work this little piece out right here. So they were not able to benefit from the gain of the word. And of course, you know, Matthew Henry, he writes in that old English, so I'm trying to sort it through and make it a little bit more modern. And so what happened was eventually the plant was overcome by the things of the world. Watch this. Prosperity will destroy the word in the heart. Did y'all hear that? I'm going to say that one more time. Prosperity destroys the word in the heart as much as what persecution can do. But it's more dangerous, watch this, because it's more silent. Ooh, I hope y'all hearing that. The danger of prosperity is such a silent killer. Amen. Come on now, am I talking real now? It's a silent voice. Just like my friend here, Mr. Deceiver. Come here, Mr. Deceiver. Now y'all remember last week, for those that weren't here, I was invited over to my sister's house, and she said that she was gonna cook me some fried chicken, you know. She was gonna have some mashed potatoes ready for me. And she went on and made a homemade, not like Miss Shirley's, but I'm sure she put her foot in it now. She made me a homemade pecan pie. So now y'all know the way to the man's heart is through his
stomach.
Okay. So now, you know, with that done passed, and you know, and I kind of got through that, you know, and hey, Mr. Deceiver. But watch this. So now my sister had called me back up again and invited me back on over to the house. So where's my sister? Where's she at? Now y'all watch this. That's right, round two.
You know she's hot.
Now see, I done told Mr. Deceiver, look, watch this. I'm a man of God, and I'm going to be obedient to the word of God. So Lord, you know all I did? I went over there, I ate my chicken. Oh, I got my little bit of dessert, and then I bounced. You know what I'm saying? I was out of there because, you know, that old deceiver, you know, he will try to come and mess me up, right? So now my sister already invited me back over for a second time. So watch this.
Nobody will know.
What's up, boo? What's good? What's going on?
That rise.
How was your day?
It's good.
Good. Yeah. You look a little tense there. You look like you need to kind of unwind a little bit, you know?
I do. I'm tired. I've had a long week.
Yeah.
I need to go change.
You can do this.
Okay. Well, then you go change, get yourself relaxed. I'm going to be sitting right here drinking my Kool-Aid.
You stay right here.
Uh-uh.
You stay right here.
Oh, wait a minute. What just happened? Wait a minute. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Now, in the meantime, while you see how deceiving is trying to cling on me, at the same time, now I got the Holy Spirit whispering in my ear. Come on, Holy Ghost. Wait a minute now. Somebody got to be the voice of reason.
You got to pull off the old man, Willie.
Somebody got to be the voice of reason.
You can't fulfill the desires of the flesh, Willie.
Oh, what's that?
You have to resist him.
Got to resist.
Flee.
Well, I mean, but no, you don't see that? Hey, you don't see. Clickety clack clack. Boom. Hey,
you got to put off the old man, Willie.
Well, I don't know.
You got to rely on the word, Willie.
Oh, man.
She's a looker, too. A cooker.
Don't be snared, Willie.
Oh. Come on. What is that perfume I smell?
I'm here for you, Willie.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I'm feeling the spirit right now.
All you have to do is call his name, Willie.
I need a massage.
You need a massage?
Hey, this is your uncle.
Well, you got some oil or something? I mean.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Don't give in to the temptation, Willie.
Oh, yeah.
Wait a minute.
Oh, yeah.
Don't give in, Willie, to the temptation.
All you have to do is
reach out and call my name.
Don't listen to that.
Come on, Willie.
It's just a little rub, man. Ain't no big thing.
You're walking down the wrong path, Willie.
You're loving your sister here.
Wait a minute.
I can't help you, Willie, unless you call on me.
Wait a minute, Lord.
Come on, Willie. Resist.
I give up. Thank you, sir. Okay. Okay. So y'all see that, right?
Yeah.
Now, isn't that how subtle sin can be? See, watch this. See, the reason, thank you, Holy Ghost. See, the reason why we get choked by the word, the enemy is able to use not only our weight against us, number one, he uses that weight against us. And what the weight is, the weight that I was standing on was my weight of pride, because see, I thought I had this. See, I thought that when I was going over to the house, I was going to be okay. And nothing wasn't going to happen to me because I'm strong enough. I got this word. But then you see what happened as I begin to consider what was going on in front of me. I began to give in. Now you hear the Holy Spirit the whole time saying, look, son. You are more than a conqueror. Your body's not your own, for you have been bought for a price. So you see the Holy Spirit's at work, but because I wanted what I wanted more than what I wanted when it came to the word, then I watch this. So not only did he use my weight of pride against me, but eventually he took me down, and eventually he began to choke. He began to suffocate me. And watch this. And when you're choked and when you're suffocation, you have a hard time breathe in. The Holy Spirit is like the wind. Amen? He represents the wind. And as long as the deceiver can cut my wind, then the word would get choked. Come on now, let's give God a hand clap with that. Come on now. Come on now. So my question is, as we're going through life and as we're battling and as we're wrestling and as we're tugging and as we're going through, how many times we can lift up, don't show no hands now, but let's just say this in our heart. How many times that when we've been in the battle and we've been in the fight, that the deceiver actually choked the word out of us and we eventually, I give up. Come on now. Come on now. And so that's why it's so important, church, to watch what's growing in your garden. See, you just can't let your garden just run wild, amen? You can't let your garden just do what you think you want to do or what you assume it's supposed to do or whatever. It's your responsibility to make sure that these thorns and these thistles are not choking and interfering with the growth of the kingdom in your life. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And see, this is why we got to be real with ourselves. That's why we do have to have accountability. And I told y'all once before, when me and the dudes used to go out, it used to be a group of us because, see, I know me. I can't speak for y'all, but I know me. And when you're in places where, you know, all kind of stuff is happening around you, it is so, so easy. Let me give you an example one time. This is a true story. So me and my buddy, we were going hanging out, and we just loved going to this jazz club. Oh, I love jazz music. So got any great jazz music, I'll take it, you know, contemporary jazz, that is. And so we were hanging out, and we were chilling. And so all of a sudden, man, it was spring break. So, man, the place was packed, you know. But the thing about it is, we always made a pact. When we go out, we make sure we watch each other's back. Okay? Now, I don't know what happened to my dude, man. I thought he had my back, man. I'm looking around. He over there talking to two gals, and he just leave me all by myself. I'm like, man, look at this joker right here. That's Butter Biscuit. Now, he's supposed to have my back. We're supposed to be hanging out. He over there hollering at the girls. Which ain't nothing wrong with that. I mean, that's cool. So now watch this. So I'm like, you know, I'm hanging out, whatever, man, you know, whatever, they playing the music. And then all of a sudden, I see the sister walk through the door, and I said, oh, Lord, what is that? I'm just keeping it real, y'all. I said, what is that? I said, Lord. So I said, I got to talk to this. Hey, I said, I can't let this one pass me by. So I walked on over, you know, and, you know, I try to be suave and cool, pastor. You know how we do it, you know. So, you know, I kicked a little game to her, you know, a little spit, a little something. Yeah, you know, cool. And I said, well, you know, why don't you, you know, just get one little dance with me, you know, no problem. She said, well, I tell you what, you know, let's just sit and talk for a while. I said, okay, that's cool. So we're sitting there talking, we rapping, whatever. And then she went to the rest, and she said, well, let's dance. I said, okay, oh, man. So I'm looking at my man, and I'm just like, you know, I'm giving him that look like, yeah, you know what time it is, dude. I'm walking on the floor, you know, showing off, whatever, right? But here's the thing. Now, watch this now. Here's my point. I had to actually cut the thing off because I know me, okay? I know me. So we're dancing, and the song, I said, man, I shouldn't even be dancing to this song. Marvin Gaye, Let's Get It On. All right, y'all know what time it is with that Marvin Gaye, you know. And I said, Lord, what am I? And this conflict, seriously, dude, and this conflict is running in my mind. What the heck am I doing here? What am I doing, right? So with that, and man, you know, I'm having a good time. She having a good time. We talking, laughing, giggling. And then all of a sudden, you know, and then, you know, then I took her by the hand and I twirled her around one time, you know, like this. I said, Lord, have mercy. I said, Lord, I got to stop. I said, I gotta quit. Because see, thank God for the Holy Spirit. Thank God for the Word. Because if I continued and knowing how the flesh can be, then the next morning I would have been crying the blues, you know. What in the world did I do that? What happened, Lord? You know what I'm talking about? So thank God for the Holy Spirit that in advance I didn't give the deceiver an opportunity to choke out my word. And at least, yeah, I look stupid, and yeah, I might have looked silly, and yeah, she's like, why you ain't getting my number and all this, so on and so forth. But I said, well, that's all right, because at least now I can go to bed. I ain't got, you know, Jesus not busting me in the head. You know, I can sleep good, you know. I don't have nothing to worry about. I have to somebody say, I'm pregnant, you know. You know, you the daddy, you my baby daddy, you know. See, I don't have any of that mess to worry about. Hallelujah. And so that's because I didn't want anything choking out the word that is in me. So you got to be persistent, folk. You got to be persistent, because like Pastor said, it's not that we can't sin, and it's not that things are going to come our way, because something's going to come, and I don't want to get too far ahead of myself, but something's going to come, and it's going to test the word that you say you know. That word going to get tested. Oh, you're talking about you're going to stay pure and clean and holy and all that? Okay, bam, let me send that thing right through the dough. And now you're dancing to Let's Get It On, Marvin Gaye. Let's see if he is who we really say he is. And the enemy's doing the same thing to every one of you. Let me see. Oh, they talking about they so and they holy and they godly and they that. Let's see if they are who they say they are. So are you who you say you really are? When it really comes down to the real test. Hallelujah. We can't, I'm telling you folks, we all make mistakes. I understand that, and God understands that. Pastor, I mean, we all understand the concept of making mistakes. A mistake is one thing, but if I'm living in my mistake and my mistake becomes a habit and I'm dwelling and I'm living in my continual habit that I know is sinful, then that's something wrong. That's a whole different horse of a different color. That's a whole different horse of a different color. Hallelujah. Okay. Can we go deeper now? Watch this. Here we go. So we know there are two particular things that's going to choke out the word. First of all, it's the cares of this world. You know, man, when I look around, there are a lot of hurting people in this world. Can we be real about that? There are a lot of hurting people in the church. And the Lord says that it's because of these cares of the world, it's choking out the world of the kingdom within us. Amen? See, the seed is going to definitely spring up. But guess what? The world is going to be right there to choke it. They are going to choke it because they want to curse what's going on in your life. The enemy don't want to see you grow. Thank you, Holy Ghost. He don't want to see you grow to your fullest potential. See, if I'm going to plant a tree, I want to make sure that I'm going to take care of this tree, because I want to know whether this tree is going to grow to the fullest potential so that it can produce the fruit that I'm expecting from the tree. So now Jesus is working on our hearts, and he's working on getting the word in our hearts so that we can reach the fullest potential, so that the fruit will be born, some 30, some 60, some 100-fold. He wants fruit to be born, to be birthed out of our whole spiritual growth. Amen. Why? Because I've said it before, so that when somebody comes along and they begin to taste your fruit, then they can say, well, I'm tasting and seeing that the Lord is good. This is the real deal right here. I don't want to eat rotten fruit. I don't want to eat old fruit. I don't want to eat stale fruit, and neither does the world. See, they're already choked. They're probably almost like this right here. maybe even like this road right here, the world is. But they need somebody, bless you, they need someone that can say, you know what, I've been where you are, and I was about to go down, and the world was choking me, fear was choking me, anxiety was choking me, worry was choking me, pain was choking me, hopelessness was choking me, so many things were choking me, but by the grace of God, I was able to take my little ratchet called the Word of God, and I began to chop these things down, and I began to get it out of my life, hallelujah, and I told the devil, you're not going to take me. And now look at the fruit that is growing in my life, because I refuse to let the cares of the world take me under. Hallelujah. Come on now, y'all getting something out of this? Okay. Now watch this. See, worldly cares are a great hindrance to our profiting the word. What it does is the cares will eat up the vigor of the soul, which should be focused on divine things. And not only will it eat our vigor, it will divert us from our duty. It will distract us from our duty. And what's going to cause is a whole lot of mischief. When you get distracted from your duty, you're going to be led into mischief. You're going to be led astray. That's why we got to make sure we stayed focused, because the enemy's going to bring it. Things are coming our way. Things are going to happen. What are you going to do when it comes your way? As a matter of fact, let's look at a couple of scriptures here, and it'll kind of solidify this. Right, watch this, and I love this. I love this. Okay, let's turn to 1 Peter Wanye, chapter 5, and verse 6 and 7. And this is, I hope that we really get something out of this right here. 1 Peter chapter 5, and Miss Rachel, verse 6 and 7. Whenever you're ready.
Therefore, humble yourselves, demote, lower yourselves in your own estimation, mm-hmm. under the mighty hand of God, that in due time he may exalt you.
Okay, hold. Now you see, y'all remember the skit that we were just portraying just a second ago. Because I did not humble myself and adhere the voice of the Holy Spirit, I actually exalted my flesh above the Holy Spirit. I exalted my flesh above the Word. Therefore, I stumbled and I fell. And every time every time temptation comes and we exalt our flesh above the Word and we exalt our flesh above the Holy Spirit, we are going to fall. Go ahead, ma'am. Verse 7.
Casting the whole of your care, all your anxieties, all your worries, all your concerns, once and for all, on him. For he cares for you affectionately and cares about you watchfully.
Amen. So see, we got God in our lives, y'all. And he is big enough to take on or to bear any burdens that you bear. See, the problem is, and I heard this in the Holy Ghost. I heard this in the Holy Ghost. And received this. He said, the problem is, folks, we got too much clutter in our lives. Too much of the world and the ways of the world and the mindset of the world is cluttering our lives. And so therefore, we carry around our clutter with us. We carry around these burdens with us. We carry around these things with us. And then what we do is the enemy comes along and keeps tempting. So we just keep adding more stuff, more clutter, more clutter, more clutter. And then when we really need the Word, we really need the power, we really need the anointing, we can't get it because we got too much clutter in our lives. We're carrying around too much baggage. And the Lord says, why don't you cast that thing upon me? When you get tempted, all you're supposed to do is cast it upon the Lord. And cast it upon the Lord and he will carry it. He didn't ask you to carry your clutter. As a matter of fact, what you're supposed to be doing with your clutter is dumping it on the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Putting it in his hands. Quit picking the stuff up and putting it in your little basket and toting the thing around. Amen. Quit doing it. Quit doing it.
Quit letting other people put their mess in your bag.
Okay, now. Okay, now. I know y'all heard that. Because it's real out here. And I really believe that God is giving us this word because, again, he's trying to take us somewhere, church. He's wanting to do something in our lives. But if we're not willing to get rid of the clutter that's in your lives, church, I'm speaking now. That's what I heard the Holy Ghost say to me, Pastor. If we keep messing around with this clutter, then the clutter is just like these thorns right here, just choking out the word. And we're supposed to be living by the power that comes through the root system called the word. Amen. So that we can be able to bear and do and go forward and do the things that God has called us to do. Amen. You're not going to be able to do it. We got too much clutter. Somebody say, clear the clutter.
Clear the clutter.
Come on, clear the clutter.
Clear the clutter.
We've got to get this mess out of the way. Amen. Now watch this. Psalms 55 and 22, please, Wanye. Are y'all getting something out of this? I hope so. Okay. Psalms 55 and 22. Go ahead, Miss Rachel.
Cast your burden on the Lord, releasing the weight of it, and he will sustain you.
Right.
He will never allow the consistently righteous to be moved,
Amen.
Made to slip, fall, or fail.
Mm-hmm. So see, watch this. Now this, you know what? Okay, we talked about casting the burden, but you know what really caught me in the spirit was when it says releasing the weight of it. See, so many times when the cares of the world come upon us, it just, like I said earlier, it just weighs us down. How sweet it is to just be able to take this thing and just cast it upon the Lord. Now watch this. Remember, I said it was the weight that the enemy used against me. See, that's why the Lord said, cast all your cares. Now, if you're not casting it, that means you're carrying it. And so, therefore, if I'm carrying all this mess, Pastor, when I got into the situation and the sister took it one step further and I went one step further with her and then she took it another step and I took it another step. And then next thing you know, the weight of my pride, the weight of my arrogance, the weight of standing on who I think I am instead of standing upon the word caused me to fall. Hallelujah. And it will do it every time, folks. Don't you think because you've been in this house so many, I mean, it's great. We love church attendance. We're glad you've been in here for a long time. But don't you rest your weight on that. Don't rest your weight on your church attendance. Don't rest your weight on you're a praise and worship leader. Don't even rest your weight on thinking that you're a leader in this house. That's not what we stand on. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. And some of us are just sinking in the sand. Don't be sand sinkers, amen. Don't sink in the sand, amen. Stand on the rock and not on yourself.
Amen.
Too many hard rocks in the church. Too many hard rocks in the church. And remember, we talked about last week that our lives are supposed to be moldable. Our lives are supposed to be shapeable. He is the potter and we are the And sometimes when the potter is working this masterpiece called the vase or whatever he's trying to do, sometimes he just has to smash it down and start all over again. And that's okay. But don't you judge the one that got smashed. If you're looking polished and shiny and glittery, man, praise God, that is good. But for some of us have been smashed several times. Amen. But boy, he's making something beautiful. When he finishes with it and he shapes it out and makes it what it needs to be, it's going to be beautiful. That's why, and I thank God, that when I came into this house and started counseling and so on and so forth, you know, everybody embraced, pastor embraced, encouraged and so on and so forth. It is so necessary, because many times as we move on, church, and as we, I want to be packed, amen, in Jesus' name. I want to see the back packed up in Jesus' name. I want to see us busting out this wall, amen, so that we got to add additions to the church. You know what I'm saying? That's what I'm believing for, amen. I believe that's what the pastors are believing for, amen. They want to see growth. They want to see the Holy Ghost. They want to see the power of God move, and God is doing it. God is doing it, and he's getting us prepared by bringing this kind of word in the house, amen. I'm not saying me. I'm just a puppet. But he's giving us something. Why is he saying all this? Why would he say all this? That's right, to get us ready, to get our hearts and our lives and our minds ready so that we can move forward and we can help those that need to be helped. But we can't help nobody if we ourselves are all jacked up.
That's right.
Hallelujah. We got to stop this mess, y'all. Stop the mess. Let's move forward, amen. I want to move forward, amen. Forget, you know, that's why Paul was an amazing man. The man was stoned. The man was shipwrecked. The man was beaten and left for dead. And yet he still said, forgetting all those things which are behind me. And I bet you some of the people that picked up the stones, the stoning was his brethren. The Christians. Come on, just like the Pharisees and the Sadducees, they, you know, picking up the stones and stoning their own brother. But he didn't hold it against them. He just said, that's okay, I'm moving on for the kingdom. And some of us got the mindset, I'm moving on for the kingdom. I'm pressing towards the prize of the high calling of Christ Jesus, and I'm not going to let the cares of this world choke me out. I'm not going to let the cares steal my wind. Don't let the cares of this world steal your wind. Because we're going to be held accountable. And we forget so easily that one day we're going to stand before God and we're going to give an account of every word, every action. And Lord, sometimes when I think of that, I said, oh, Lord God, do we have to really do that? Because I know I've done some messed up stuff and I've done some jacked up stuff. But, oh, Lord, nevertheless, I understand. But at least while I'm living, I want to make sure that the kingdom is living inside of me and moving forward inside of me. Amen. And I pray for our house that the kingdom is living inside you and that we're moving forward in the kingdom and we're going to see greater things happen because of the kingdom. Amen. But we got to get rid of the cares. Everybody say, cast the cares. Come on, cast the cares. We got to cast our cares upon the Lord. Okay, now turn to John 16 and 33, please. John 16 and 33. Is everybody good? We good?
We're good.
Okay. We keep it moving. Y'all know y'all got me up here late, so y'all know what time it is. I'm just teasing. Okay, John 16 and 33. John 16 and 33. Here we go, Miss Rachel.
I have told you these things so that in me you may have perfect peace and
confidence.
Okay,
hold up. What kind of peace?
Perfect.
What kind of peace?
Perfect.
Okay, go ahead, Miss Rachel.
In the world you have tribulation and trials and distress and frustration, but be of good cheer, take courage, be confident, certain, undaunted, for I have overcome the world. I have deprived it of power to harm you and have conquered it for you.
Okay. So y'all see the word right here. He said, and the part that I love, he says, I have deprived it of power to harm you and to have conquered it for you. Now, here's the thing. Now, we see that with the Billy Graham thing and the fella caught the disease right there. Well, wait a minute. Now, how could that be? Lord, why you let the man get the disease? Maybe my body might have the disease, but it's not conquering my faith inside of me. And that's why he survived. And he said, whether I live or whether I die, I'm still going to serve the Lord. And that's because God deprived the power of the world to harm the word that's already inside of me. But see, if I have not the word, but the world inside of me, well, then that's when we begin to experience harm. Maybe it may not be physical harm, but it's spiritual harm. And that's just as dangerous as being physically harmed. But you have to know and understand, Jesus deprived the world of power to harm you, and he has conquered the world for you. Man, I'm telling you, if anybody can talk about conquering, I'm going to talk about it, because man, I was in the bed and he got me out the grave. And every day when I wake up, Pastor, I'm determined. And it's not, I'm just not bragging on me, I'm just saying, look what the Lord has done and is doing. I'm confident and I'm conquering and I'm moving and I'm stomping in the Holy Ghost. And if all of us are conquering and moving and stomping of the Holy Ghost, the glory of God is going to hit this place. We all going to be laid out on the floor and we're going to see great things happen in this house. Amen. Come on, somebody give God a hand clap. Come on now. Come on now. And here's the thing. Thank you, Lord. How many people are going through tribulations and trials and distresses and frustrations and can't be of good cheer?
Right.
Have no courage. But we as the believers, this is something that we're supposed to take. This is something that we're supposed to possess. But again, if we're allowing the cares to ultimately choke out the word, then we're going to die. It's too many dead Christians in the house, y'all. Hallelujah. Too many are dead. Too many are choked. They're just, they're grasping because they've allowed so much to come into their lives where they can't breathe. You know, back in the day, you know, the boys, we always used to tell each other, you know, breathe easy. In Christ, we're supposed to be breathing easy. Amen. Ain't that right, Brother Charlie?
That's it, my brother.
We're supposed to breathe easy. I don't want nothing cutting off. And I remember, like, Floyd had me in a chokehold. He almost had me passed out from the chokehold. I said, wait a minute. I said, Floyd, wait a minute. We're supposed to be practicing, not the real thing here. Wait a minute. But the thing about it is, I didn't even say it to him, but he says this particular chokehold would actually cut off the wind of the person and eventually they would pass out. And we got the devil chokeholding and choking too many of us, and we're just passing out, just passing out. We don't even realize, but we're just passing out, grasping. But thank God for his grace and his mercy that we got men of God and women of God like Pastor Michelle's doing her teaching, the folks that do the teaching, that he's trying to breathe life back into us and reach those spots where we become a hard rock. And we all got them. Amen. We got some hard spots now. But he said what? I'd rather you have a heart of flesh and not a heart of stone. You got to get rid of the stones, y'all. No rolling stones. But get rid of the stones. Amen. Okay. Y'all get something out of this. Here we go. Now, let's see. Okay. Now, let's go back to 1 Peter chapter 5 and all this is good. This, we're going to get something really good out of this. Watch this. 1 Peter chapter 5, and let's start with verse 8. 1 Peter chapter 5, and we're going to start with verse 8. Now, before you read that, let me read this. So, we have the cares of the world, and then we have the next thing is the deceitfulness of riches. They continue to be hearers of the word, but yet they're still in a snare. Watch this. It's hard for them to enter the kingdom of heaven. Now watch this. I'm going to explain this. It's two levels of slavery that comes behind the deceitfulness of riches. They don't even have kingdom life. They don't have eternal life. They're lost. But watch this. But for believers who get ensnared in the deceitfulness of riches, you're cutting off your kingdom life. You're cutting off your kingdom life, and you wonder why, or we would wonder why, or I wonder why, you know, like for an example, when I told you about when I was in this situation over here, not so much it was because of the deceitfulness of riches, but it was the deceitfulness of riches because there was something, and as I kind of thought back on it, as the Lord was kind of whispering in my ear during certain times of transition, and I thought, okay, well, no, there's that just sounds so absurd, Lord. There is no way. You see what's going on right about now? But because I didn't listen, because I thought that this would be the better way, this would benefit me more, Father God, financially, I decided to go and do my own thing. You see? It's the deceitfulness of riches. And then when I made the wrong choice or something would happen, then you want to blame God. But we can't blame God for that. Amen. Come on now. Let's be real. We can't blame God for that. But what happens is now you have to say, OK, well, Lord, here's what it is, what it is. Now, what are we going to do? And now the Lord says, OK, now that you finally coming back to listen to me, now let's see how we're going to get this thing right. But I had my eye focused on something that I really wanted. And I wanted that more than what the Holy Spirit was trying to tell me at that particular time, Pastor. That's why riches are deceitful. And that's why in these last hours, folks, we have got to be so careful about that. We can't be getting involved in no mess. We can't be getting because watch the you know, we it's so easy to take the power from God and put it in your own hands. We don't even give God a chance to prove himself because we already done figured it out. We already got a plan. We got a hustle. We got a game. We got an angle already. And we didn't even give faith a chance. And then we wonder why we're just sitting on just the edge of the glory. We're sitting on the edge of the blessing. We're sitting on the edge because we don't give faith a chance because we're so quick to jump because it's such a great thing right here, Papa. Oh, Lord, thank you for this blessing. Come on now. Faith without works is dead. But we don't even give faith a chance to work. Come on, folks. And we wonder why we're so spiritually impotent. Oh, I'm strong and we can be strong in this area. I'm good in this area. But then where it really counts, when the testing comes and temptation comes, that's when you really need the power. That's when it really kicks in. Okay? We got to quit cutting God off. And if we're faith people, how can I teach another man faith if I ain't living it myself?
That's right.
And then see who I am is what I'm going to reflect to somebody else. So what are you reflecting when it comes to your faith? When it comes to, again, as it says, the deceitfulness of riches, because it's hard for people to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Watch this. See, they're apt to promise themselves that the riches don't have me. It's not under my sway. It's not under my control. But watch this. Watch this. Watch this, how mischievous it is. They cannot realize that when you put your confidence in something more than putting your confidence in God, you're being misled. And not only are you putting your confidence in it, but now you're getting an expectation from the hustle. That's leading us astray. And these expectations and this confidence, not in God, not exercising my faith, is what's going to choke out the good seed of the word. Come on now. Don't shout me down now. Come on now. Is that real talk or what, folks?
Yes.
This is real. This is real Christian. And thank God we can be real in this house. Thank God. And I mean, if I couldn't, I still was going to preach it either way. Either way. You know? Because I know, and we all know that, you know, love covers a multitude of sins. So God is just trying to get us somewhere. Amen, Pastor? And he does it through love. Again, in my heart, no condemnation. No condemnation here. I'm just saying what the man said, and I'm just expounding on what the man said. Okay, now let's read that scripture real quick. Go ahead, Miss Rachel.
Be well balanced, mm-hmm. temperate, sober of mind. Be vigilant and cautious at all times. Mm-hmm. For that enemy of yours, the devil, roams around like a lion, roaring in fierce hunger, seeking someone to seize upon and devour.
Okay, now, this is the word that really blessed me right here. Everybody say temperate. She says, be well balanced and be temperate. Say it one more time, temperate. Okay, now let me give you the definition of that. The definition of temperate means moderate in one's actions, self-restraint, not self-indulgent, okay? Now, if we break that down even more, the Latin root of that is, it's called temperare. It's T-E-M-P-E-R-A-R-E. And watch this. It says to observe proper measure. To observe the proper mix or to regulate. Now, and watch this as we take it even further. Now, the root word of that is temp, T-E-M-P. And watch this. It means to stretch thin. To stretch thin. Come on now. So, what the word is going to do is stretch us when it comes to our faith. Yeah. See, the roots stretch themselves down. The shoot stretch themselves up. Amen. So the Lord said, this is why you have to be temperate. This is why you have to be well balanced in your mind. This is why you have to be moderate in your actions. This is why we have to have self-restraint, and we can't be so self-indulgent, because what God is trying to do is he's going to stretch your faith. Amen. Have your faith been stretched lately? Come on now. Has your faith been stretched lately? Amen. Amen. And so that's why I like that word. I mean, I just think that this just is so strong that we have to, in our minds, make sure that we are temperate, and also that we're also sober of mind. Now, I remember y'all remember when we did the teaching on the batak? Y'all remember that? Yeah. On confidence, the batak? And we were saying that the problem is a lot of people can't be sober of mind because they're intoxicated with their own religious, I don't even know what to call it, religious confidence, I guess, if you will. Being self-confident, I guess, if you will. Amen. So the Bible says this is why you have to be sober of mind. And the opposite of sober is what? Being intoxicated. See, I was so, when I was at the sister's house or when I was at the club and I saw the sister, I immediately became intoxicated with her looks. When I was over at the sister's house, I immediately came intoxicated. Boy, she had on that nice perfume and she was all relaxed, and I was getting intoxicated. And so therefore, once I'm intoxicated, the word and the Holy Spirit's trying to speak, but I can't pay him no mind. I'm not really hearing him clearly because I'm so focused on what I'm looking at right here, and I become drunk. I become enamored. I become intoxicated with her beauty. And isn't that like sin? Doesn't it look intoxicating? Doesn't it look seductive? Doesn't it look like, man, this is something that I need to be a part of? But all it is doing is it's getting us drunk. And so that's why when it says be well balanced, be temperate. And now the Lord, the Holy Spirit, is trying to temper our flesh. He's trying to temper that attitude. He's trying to temper that lust. He's trying to temper. Then there's nothing that that tempering is going to do anyways. Because I forget that. I'm starting. Yeah, that's what I want, you know. And don't we do the same thing? Amen. We all do it. So that's why it says, be sober. Now, here's the next scripture right here. Turn to Romans chapter 12, verse 3. Romans chapter 12, verse 3. Okay, and I'm gonna wrap this up here shortly.
You ready?
Go ahead.
For by the grace, unmerited favor of God given to me, I warn everyone among you not to estimate and think of himself more highly than he ought, not to have an exaggerated opinion of his own importance, but to rate his ability with sober judgment, each according to the degree of faith apportioned by God to him.
You see? I mean, the word is pretty self-explanatory, you know? So as I'm looking at it again, not to have an exaggerated opinion of his own self, because all you're doing is focusing on self. And if I'm focusing on self, then I'm taking the focus off Christ. And so therefore, when something does come my way to try to tempt me, if I'm not looking towards Jesus, who is the author of my faith, and I'm just looking at myself, then again, y'all saw me. I just said, well, I got this. I can't be tempted. I'm not going to fall. And what happened? I fell. Sorry? That's when we have the greatest fall. And it happens to so many. So many. It's so easy. This, you know, if Christianity was so easy, everybody would be doing it. But we try to make it what it's really not. Come on. Is that true talk or what? We can't bring God down to our so-called standards and say, well, this is how it is, God. God says, no, I'm trying to get you to go up on your standards and be where I'm at, because the word already says that we're seated in the heavenlies already, Ephesians chapter 2. So then why am I going to step out of my seat and come down and run around in the mud with the pigs? Amen. And that's deceitfulness of riches. You step down from your position and you just came down, and now you're wallowing in the mud. You're wallowing in the mess. So all I can just say is, because I know it's getting late, Pastor, all I can just say is this. You know what's going on between you and God. It's you know, and I would just say, just like I say to myself all the time, you know, when I'm dealing with people and when I'm out there and trying to be a, you know, witness and so on and so forth, you know, again, Pastor says it all the time. It's love that covers the multitudes of sin. Let's do what we're supposed to do. Let's get right what we're supposed to get right, because here's the last example that I'm going to give. The Lord told me to show y'all this. When I heard, Pastor, that the prophet was saying that the Great Awakening is coming. It's going to begin to start spreading. And I kind of saw our church just like this. But as we come together and as we put aside all of our cares and we begin to kick out and cut away all this clutter and these thorns and these thistles, and not be carried about by the cares of the world, and not be so caught up in the deceitfulness of the riches and all these other things, that God's going to begin to unfold his glory in this house. I'm telling you, I heard that in the spirit. I heard that in the spirit. And the more we become one, another layer unfolds of the glory in this house. And the more we continue to be one, another layer is going to glory until the power and the glory of God is just manifesting in this house every time we walk in this house. And I said, well, Lord, why am I using a wash rag? Because there's going to be some people who's going to come in here and they need their feet washed by the glory of God. Maybe they might need their face washed by the glory of God. Or maybe, if you will, we'll take the glory and begin to wipe away the tears from their eyes.
Amen.
Amen. That's why he's trying to unveil the glory. Amen, Mom? That's why he's trying to unveil the glory in our lives, the truths in our lives, because there's someone that's going to need. Amen. But it's not going to happen, hallelujah, if we're carrying around these cares. It's not going to happen if we're being choked and our fruit is being choked by these thorns and these thistles. If we're being choked and unable to produce the kind of fruit like this, the beauty. We know there's no perfect church. There's no perfect church, but we have a perfect Savior. We have a risen Savior. We have a holy Savior. We got a mighty Savior. Amen. And that's why I love when the scripture, when it says, one of these days, every tear will be wiped away. And I heard this old preacher the other day. And I mean, I haven't heard fiery preaching like this. I mean, he was old school, old school. And he said, well, it'll never be said of me that I never told anybody about hell. I mean, that kind of preacher, you know, I mean, he was old school, man. He was just straight up with it. But I loved it, man. I thought this was cool, you know. And I sure would hate to be the one when I stand before the Lord and the Lord says, I was trying to get my glory in your house, but you wanted it because you didn't like who God was using. Come on now. That's why it's not about the vessel.
That's right.
Thank you, Holy Ghost. If God sends us a Joseph, don't be a dream killer. Don't be casting the Josephs in the ditch. Amen. If God decides to bring us Davids in this house, don't just throw them out to the, and you just worry about the sheep way out there in the field. That David is a giant killer. Welcome them Davids. Welcome them Josephs, amen. Welcome the Marthas and the Marys, amen. This is all part of the plan. Don't impede what God is wanting to do, amen. If you got a dream, if you got a vision, and you okay it with the man of God and the Spirit okays it with him, then what he's going to do, he's going to say, go for it. Go for it, son. Go for it, daughter, so that the glory of God can be unveiled. Amen.
Amen.
Come on, somebody say, I want the glory.
I want the glory.
Somebody say, Lord, show me your glory. Come on, Lord, show me your glory. Don't impede the glory. Don't allow these thorns and these thistles and these deceptions and these lies and these quick fixes to choke out the real thing. One last thing, Pastor, and I'm going to close because the Lord just told, and I have to get this one in. If you're a hard rock, you know what Jesus said? If you're a hard rock today, Jesus says, because the word says that the seed was sown along the wayside. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, amen? All right? And then watch this. If you're one of these that's still on the rock, and you're hearing this word, and you spring up, and you don't have a proper root system, remember what we read last week, Rachel? That Jesus is the root. Amen? The word is the root. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then watch this. And if you know you got thorns and you got thistles and you got things growing out of your life, guess what? He said that you can have peace because they put all of that upon my head so that you can have peace. Amen. Hallelujah. And here's the good ground right here. 30, 60, and 100-fold. This is how I want your faith to grow. This is how I want you to be. This is how I want you to look like when the world looks at you. I may not be perfect, but you're going to see some good fruit on this tree. I might have a few little rotten ones, and the Lord's working on that one, amen? But you're going to see some good fruit. And we gather up all of these fruits into the house, and we put them in a basket, and we just take it to the world. Here, have one. Have an orange. Have a banana. Have an apple. There you go. Have some grapes. You see? Taste and see that the Lord is good. Come on now. Amen. Y'all know I love you. Charlie, you know I love you, man. Brother Floyd, you know I love you. Mickey, you know I love you, girl. Y'all know I love y'all. And I love this house. And I love what the kingdom is doing in this hour. Let's go for it in Jesus' name. Pastor, God bless you.